Now the angel said unto her, Fear not, Mary, for thou hast found favor with God. And behold, thou shalt conceive in thy womb and bring forth a son, shall call his name Jesus. Now this is very plain language, don't you think? I think it's very plain. No way of misinterpreting it. He shall be great and shall be called a son of the highest, and the Lord God shall give unto him the throne of his father David. You see, all of this is quite literal. These folk who've denied the virgin birth also do not think he's going to sit on the throne of his father David. But apparently it was understood that everything here was literal. The virgin's womb was literal, and the throne of David is literal. He shall reign over the house of Jacob, and that's literal, forever. And of his kingdom there shall be no end. And that kingdom is a reality. Then said Mary unto the angel, How shall this be, seeing I know not a man? And you know, she was the first one that questioned the virgin birth. She said, How can it be? And it's still a good question, by the way. And the answer is given by Dr. Luke here, and he's quoting the angel Gabriel. Verse 35, And the angel answered and said unto her, The Holy Spirit shall come upon thee, and the power of the highest shall overshadow thee. You see, no man had anything to do with the birth of Jesus. Therefore also that holy thing, let's understand that holy thing. Now back in the book of Leviticus, we saw that the birth of a child caused a woman to be unclean. Why? Well, because she brought a sinner into the world. But now, Dr. Luke makes it clear here, quoting the angel says, that's not a sinner you're bringing into the world. And this is the only way that you could get that holy thing into the world, my friend. David said, in sin did my mother conceive me. Well, not Mary. This is different, you see. This is the virgin birth. Now, you can deny the virgin birth if you want to. If you're an unbeliever, I expect you to. And don't you write and tell me that you believe the virgin birth and deny the Bible. My friend, you would upset me terribly if you made a statement like that. I know you don't believe the virgin birth if you're not a Christian. But don't come along and tell me now that the Bible doesn't teach the virgin birth. You just haven't met Dr. Luke, I'm afraid. Now, will you notice? That holy thing which shall be born of thee shall be called the Son of God. And you know why he's going to be called the Son of God? Because he is the Son of God. Now, remember that Dr. Luke puts an emphasis here that is the scientific approach. He states that he examined Jesus of Nazareth, and his findings are that Jesus is God. Now, he came to the same conclusion as John did, but his procedure and his technique were different, you see. My, how marvelous and how wonderful this gospel is. Now, will you notice? And behold, thy cousin Elizabeth, she hath also conceived a son in her old age, and this is the sixth month with her, who is called barren. You see, the birth of John the Baptist is also miraculous, but not a virgin birth, by the way. Now, you'll notice the answer that the angel gives is a very good one, and it's something we need to hold on to today. Verse 37, For with God nothing shall be impossible. Now, I want to emphasize that because there are a group of people who have taken that today and twisted it and distorted it out of all proportion in the way in which it's given. There's nothing impossible with God when he says he's going to do it, but it's not necessarily so when you and I say it. In other words, a man said to me the other day, the Lord told me to do this. Well, I told him that I didn't believe the Lord told him. And he thought I was a rank unbeliever. I think a lot of people use that cliche today to cover up the fact they want their own selfish desire. I knew the Lord hadn't appeared to this man to tell him what to do, but that's what he told me. And he failed. But before he failed, he told me, he says, gave me this little cliche again, nothing's impossible with God. Yes, I said, that's true. Nothing's impossible with God, but there sure is a whole lot that's impossible with you and with me. And it must have been with him because he failed. And you see, when a man makes a wild statement like that and fails, then it causes the unbeliever to ridicule, and rightly so. But he ought not to ridicule God unless he's quite sure God really said it. Anything God determines to do, he can do it because there's nothing impossible with God. But that doesn't mean he's going to do everything I want him to do, because he may not want to do it, and that may not be his way to do it. Let's put everything in proper perspective today before we begin to do all this loud talking that hurts the cause of Christ and harms it rather than helps. Now, will you notice verse 38? And Mary said, Behold, the handmaid of the Lord, be it unto me according to thy word. And the angel departed from her. And I think this is one of the loveliest things that's ever said about Mary, is her submission to the will of God. She says, Be it unto me according to thy word. And you must remember, that very moment a cloud came over her life, and that cloud was there until the Lord Jesus came back from the dead. Now, I'm of the opinion that many of the followers had question marks. But you see, he's declared to be the Son of God with power, according to the Spirit of holiness, by his resurrection from the dead. He's declared to be not made, and the resurrection proves his virgin birth, by the way. And you can't deny the resurrection and believe the virgin birth. And you cannot believe in the resurrection and deny the virgin birth, or vice versa. And I think I had it vice versa before, but that's the way that it is. They both go together. They both stand together, or fall together, if you please. Now, we have a visit that Mary made up in the hill country to Elizabeth. You see, she's up in Nazareth. Now she comes up, and to me it's always like coming down, because when you look at the map, it looks like you'd be coming down to Jerusalem, but it's always, any direction you went to Jerusalem, you went up to Jerusalem. And so into the hill country of Judea would be up. Mary arose in those days and went into the hill country with haste into a city of Judah, entered into the house of Zacharias, and saluted Elizabeth. Came to pass that when Elizabeth heard the salutation of Mary, the babe leaped in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. Now, we're dealing with that which is miraculous here. No use try to offer a natural explanation. You either believe it or you don't believe it, friends. I'm so weary of these people, especially preachers, that are trying to appear intellectual, and they try to tone down, explain away the miracles. Now, my friend, you either accept them or you don't accept them. And here is nothing in the world but a miracle. This woman's filled with the Holy Spirit. The babe leaps in her womb. Now, that just doesn't happen today when somebody else walks up. And I know that there could be a natural explanation offered, but that's not the way it's given to us. Now, verse 42, she spake out with a loud voice and said, Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb. And here you have this very lovely song. This is the first song that has been given to us by Dr. Luke. And as I said, he was a poet. He's the one that gives us all the songs of Christmas. And this is the first one. Blessed art thou among women, not above women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb. And whence is this to me that the mother of my Lord should come to me? For lo, as soon as the voice of thy salutation sounded in mine ears, the babe leaped in my womb for joy. And blessed is she that believed, for there shall be a performance of those things which were told her from the Lord. There is a person in Scripture that we have very little to say about her, and that is this woman, Elizabeth.